Is investment something that's always been on your mind, but you don't quite know how to get started on that journey? We are here to set you on the right course. We are all about getting out of the rat race through creating positive passive income. Here you'll hear from regular people just like you and the professionals who support us towards greater wealth. Learn before you earn. Move from analysis to action and find the right path to attaining the success that you've always dreamed of for yourself. Now, here's your host, Athena.
Okay, well, welcome to Women in Investing, and this is our somewhat monthly gathering, and it's been on Zoom for a bit, and we hope to be live here in March for Women's History Month. But in the meantime, what's great about being online is we've had women join us from all across the country, and so we have a really great conversation going. And so women, my name is Athena Paquette Cormier, and I'm your host for this podcast and webinar. And so Women in Investing is a format where I interview women who've gotten out of the rat race by investing and creating passive income and cash flow and live to tell the tale. So tell us exactly how they do it. And then I also invite women who support us in growing our wealth and demystifying money. So today I'm very excited to have Damaris Johnson with us, and she's going to explain to us how, as business women, self-employed women, and just all around seekers of knowledge, is she's going to explain to us how we can create our own pensions and have growth of wealth and be able to use that money before we die or before we retire. So that excites me. I love it when I can double dip money. And to me, this is like triple dipping and more our money. So I think I mentioned in the little description, I've had a couple of these plans. And for me, they've really helped me grow my wealth. Not only the actual investments grow, but it helped me grow my other wealth by borrowing against the plan and having it grow and having a sense of security that I'm not leaving a mess behind. So Damaris, I'm so excited to have you here. I've known Damaris maybe 3-4 years. Maybe it's been 5. I don't know. It's something like that. And I always called her the boat lady and finally found out what her real name was. So Damaris, yes, is the boat lady, but she's so much more, and she's very intelligent, and she just tells it like it is, which is what we require here. Nuts and bolts and no BS. So welcome, Damaris. We're so excited to have you today. Why don't you tell everyone a little bit about yourself, your background? Who is Damaris?
Hi. So I am native born to Los Angeles. I can say that with pure joy. I am now in my second century of life. Winning
second half century. Okay. I'm like, damn, you look good.
I thought that was my
promotion. That's really good.
I'm very passionate about my work, but during our, I guess it was 15 years on the boat where we were actually living there, I came to code myself as a boat monkey, because I would be all over the place running around as second mate, and just had a, you know, had a lot of fun. That was an amazing experience. And we now live on land with four walls and ceilings and all of that. And it's kind of interesting. The only thing I really love is that I can hang pictures of my granddaughter and my plants. So otherwise, you know, it would be still both of our first choice to be still on the boat. But Here we are. I love this industry. The first time I took a look at my work was in 2013. And I had I dabbled in it. I looked at it. I couldn't get a feel for it at that time. And then I waited a few years. So back in 2017. I found myself laid off, and I said, okay, let me take another look. And I did. And that time I went ahead and I attained my license, which is a lot of fun. I went through that processing, and then I started delving right away into this product that we're going to be primarily focused on tonight, as we were discussing, Athena. It's my favorite thing in the world for so many reasons, but my primary focus in doing this job, and my way of thinking, especially in terms of women, single women, who, you know, they have aspirations for their children, they have hopes and goals and dreams, but on a single income, how do you make that happen, right?
Mm-hmm.
And so my focus has been in lifting those women up by giving them the opportunity to see how the possibilities by just a few dollars a month and how they can grow, and then how they can teach their own children. I've actually done presentations for high school kids where they, so they understand the power of this type of coverage and what it means to them in their future. So there's a whole lot of little nooks and crannies and strengths and different things that people don't understand about what life insurance can do for them and their families. And I hope that I'm able to answer those questions, or at least brings instill you with some questions that you might want to have answered later, so that you understand how this amazing tool fits into your financial toolkit. And Athena, thank you so much for the opportunity to approach the group. I really appreciate it.
Yeah.
So
great.
From the shores of Lake San Marcos to the to sunny LA, right?
Yeah.
So I'll go ahead and get started. And guys, please, if you have questions, put them in the chat box. I'm happy to answer any questions that you might have. I especially want to be helpful to those who have maybe approached life insurance in the past and they didn't find a solution. Okay. I especially want to be mindful, or make sure that you're mindful that I am, I'm here and my ears are open to what I can do. Helping resolve folks' problems is really what I love. Okay. So generally, life insurance really does play an essential part of in any individual, family, or business's toolkits in terms of finances. And it's the primary thing we're looking at is the indemnification against loss. And that loss might be financial, as in losing the primary breadwinner in the home. It might be if you own a business, maybe you as the sole proprietor have to be out for a medical procedure. You're going to be out for 6 to 8 weeks and you need a way to stopgap your earnings because you're not earning while you're not working. Right.
Mm-hmm.
So we can find those resources by leveraging the carrier, the insurance company. If I could say those simple words every like 20 times a day, I would. You want to leverage the carrier's resources, not your own. All right. A lot of times when folks tell me, well, I've got 6 homes and I've got, you know, X, Y, and Z built up. Usually those things are sitting there waiting for retirement. They're going to be at some point liquidated for retirement. But there's not a plan for what if X heinous thing happens and now we have to deal with this. So by liquidating assets too soon, you know, how do you take the time and rebuild that? Well, with life insurance, you don't necessarily have to. Okay. So that's going to be the focus of tonight, but also we're going to talk a little bit about protecting mortgage, you know, mortgage protection, offsetting excess tax in retirement, and then the benefits of corporate owned life insurance and taxes, how taxes affect those who want to put a policy in place and who are looking for options and coverage. So there's so many carriers and so many things to consider. I don't know how many of you have ever looked at a policy and then you get stuck in the analysis paralysis and then you do nothing, thereby time wasted on growth, time wasted on earnings,
Maybe you don't understand it quite fully. So you go, I don't understand it, I don't want to risk, and you move on. Like life makes you move on to other things, right? So,
that is a true factor. And you do see that with a lot of people. If you have somebody who's explaining to you the product and they don't understand how to teach you how it works. Mm-hmm. Yeah, definitely.
It just sounds like mumbo jumbo. And of course, I think in general, we as women, investors, but just in general, women are risk adverse, right? Because we know we need that money for our entire family. We, you know, we just don't take risks as much, I think, as men, right? So I think as soon as it sounds, at least this is how I react. If it sounds too mumbo jumbo-y, I'm like, I don't get it, so I don't want it, right? So
that's
I think it's almost built in nature too.
The rule of thumb is the confused individual does nothing.
Mm-hmm.
And right. So that's, you know, so it is on the, on how effective are you explaining and then actually looking, staking things out. So I'm going to be presenting some options that'll hopefully clarify those positions as well. Cause that's,
okay.
That's
and just, really just to make sure what you're talking about now is definitely how we can create a pension for ourselves, but the tools you're using are insurance based, right?
Yes.
Related. Yes. Okay. Got it.
So that's one part of the toolkit. So just to get this kind of housekeeping out of the way, I worked with carriers who primarily do simplified issue, which means that there's no doctor's visit, no nurses, nobody's coming to your home. The other thing is a lot of carriers are trying, they're really working hard to catch up with the time. And so even under certain circumstances, they are clearing people based on their age, their health, and the amount of money they want to put in place. So there's all kinds of things out there. There's a lot of little moving parts, but that's my job is to help you navigate that. And I help people from ages 0 to 89. Okay. So there's just a couple little things there. Now, just to also, all life insurance, and this, I mean, all of it is based on your age and your health. Okay. So when you're looking at options, when you hear that someone was presented this option at this amount of money, and then you go looking for the same thing and you didn't find it, well, there's a reason for that. And a lot of that can't be disclosed due to HIPAA laws. Maybe the person doesn't even know, or they're confused of what they're explaining to you, but keep that in mind too. This is not a one size fits all type of industry. This is something that's very specific that is tailored to the individual who is seeking the coverage. Okay. So keep that in mind that all of these things are affected by your age and your health and then the amount of coverage you're seeking. All right.
Okay.
Now about 60% of the people who I meet with, they have some form of group term insurance through their employer. And this needs to be said because oftentimes I say, oh no, I've got coverage through my job. Well, the best worst case scenario I've ever heard of this is a colleague who had an aunt who she had a fantastic life insurance policy through her job. And when he started working in the insurance industry, he approached his whole family, including this particular aunt. And she said, nope, I'm covered. I've got it covered. I don't need anything. Well, the scenario that played out a few years later is more typical than you might think. The individual who's covered through that group term insurance is at some point declared ill and they have to take a few months off work. And eventually the HR contacts you and says, hey, you know what? We can't hold your job anymore. Call us when you get better. And then the call us when you get better scenario never happens because usually if you're that sick, you end up passing away. Well, when you separate from the job, 90% of the time, you also lose that coverage. And now the scenario that you're looking at is that you are sick and insurable probably in only one way. And that depends on state law. So it's really, really a great rule of thumb to have some type of private coverage that you carry that you're in control of. I always ask people who are very adamant about their work coverage to just make sure, talk to HR, talk to the administrator and ask this question, is my policy portable? Okay. Is my policy portable? And if they say yes, then the next question that you have to ask is, okay, and when I leave, am I going to be able to keep the rate, the group rate, or am I going to be paying a different rate? Now, if they say you're going to be paying you're on your own, you have something to think about there. Okay. Because you're going to lose the coverage of the group and you're going to be now an individual. So your age and your health are going to be all that matter. Mm. Okay. So the rate that you're paying, the $10 or $20 a month that you're paying through work for this coverage is going to probably cost you, depending on your age at time of separation, upwards of a few hundred dollars a month if you want to keep it. Okay. So just word to the wise, don't close your head to private coverage just because you have coverage at work. Now, some terms that we're going to touch on tonight are term life coverage. Term coverage expires at the end of a set amount of time. Okay. It pays out only 3% of the time. So there's something to be said for it. Usually we put it in place for things like the mortgage protection, like I touched on before. Okay. You put it in place if you maybe think you might not be there to pay for your kids' college. Mm-hmm. Okay. So you'll see higher face values and much lower premiums because of what I said before.
Term. So it's bad news if you're cashing in on a term life insurance.
Exactly.
That's not good news. But this other pension thing that I love so much, you don't have to die to collect.
You don't have to worry about that.
Right.
Now, there are term coverages out there that will give you back at the end of the term 50, 75 or 100% of your premiums. So it's something to think about if that's the best way to go for you. So whole life, on the other hand, it tends to be pricier when we're younger just because our earnings really haven't caught up to where they're going to be. But as we age, whole life coverage becomes less expensive. It becomes less expensive as a product itself, and it becomes less expensive to in our budget. It just kind of works that way. All right.
Now, can I ask you something? Are you sharing something? Because we're not seeing anything.
No, I'm not. Am I?
Okay.
On the
video? I wasn't sure. I just wanted to make sure if you were, you know, sharing. We were not seeing anything. Okay.
Yeah. I'll let you know so you can tell me if you're seeing. So typically, we want permanent whole life coverage in place for issues that'll be triggered by our passing. Let's say that you're the sole breadwinner in your household. And if you pass away, your spouse is going to be left with nothing. We call that income replacement. Or if you're caring for an aged family member, a developmentally challenged child, anybody who depends on you for their livelihood, for their bread and water every month, those are things we put whole life coverage in place for. Okay. So now here's where these whole life policies are really winners. Let's say that I oftentimes call this death is not necessarily the worst case scenario. A lot of times the worst case scenario.
I was thinking it was.
No, I mean, think about it. If you become ill and you pass away, then the policy pays out, no big deal, right? But medicine is beating death. That doesn't mean that your quality of life is there. That doesn't mean that you're not in a, you know, wheelchair bound. That doesn't mean that you don't need a modified vehicle to be transported around in. That doesn't mean that you don't need a caretaker coming in, but you're alive. Mm. And now
I'm costing myself more by being alive is what you're saying.
Exactly. So resources that, you know, okay, like going back to selling that property. So you sell that property, but you're only 35, 40 or 50 years old and you're bound to live another 30 or 40 years, right? It becomes a lifestyle and life opportunities become a declining advantage. And it's not just impacting the sick or ill individual. It's also impacting the family, right? You have to leave college because you know, some horrible thing happened and now we're out of money. Okay, when you have cash value life insurance, there is a huge benefit because, again, going back to that term I used earlier, you're leveraging the carrier's resources instead of your own. So the properties that you own, so the retirement accounts that you've set up, all of that business, it stays intact. So you can still stay on the same timeline that you were on before without disrupting the family greatly and without putting yourself in a position where, oh my God, I now have nothing because you had to liquidate all of your assets, right? So
create a taxable event, right? So that every dollar that you cash in under duress is probably costing you 40, 50, maybe even more cents, right? That's horrific.
And so these are the types of scenarios that, they're called accidents for a reason, because we can't foresee them. Mm. But if you had something that was able to blanket cover you, if you die too soon, if you live too long, if you become ill or injured, there is a huge benefit to that. And that it's not costing you any more money. You're simply, you've put this thing in place. God bless. If you're young, you've done it at a time when it's only costing you a very little amount of money every month. And then you just continue moving on with your life. And when the worst case scenario happens, you're there to handle it. Now, I strongly, when I speak to self-employed individuals, when I speak to people who are working in industries that don't offer any kind of retirement, and when I'm talking to people who are single, this is the best thing you can do. Okay. If you're going to be a massage therapist, if you're going to be any kind of personal services individual, having cash value life insurance saves you from having not only to save up for the surgery, but also save up for the aftermath of the recovery. Mm. Okay. There's a whole little thing that happens that you just don't realize how easy it is just to make a call, say, hey, I need to take some money out. Mm-hmm. Okay. Figure it out. They email you a paper, you sign it, send it back. 48 hours later, your account's been blessed. So these things are important to consider, and they are a big deal. They affect our lives. Now, the other two types of coverage before we continue on with the main part of the discussion are guaranteed issue. And then there's also accidental death coverage, which was initially it always was the most pure form of mortgage protection. You know, you get into an accident on your way home, the wife and two kids are there. You're not coming home. Well, they get a check in a few weeks. And the only issue is, and I don't know how many of you remember, back at the beginning of COVID, a sheriff in Florida died. He died of the disease as a first line responder. And his wife had a $300,000 accidental life policy. And his wife called the insurance company, and because he didn't die in an accident, it wasn't ideal because there's no payout. It's the least expensive kind of insurance because likelihood you're probably not going to die in an accident, but still, it's a good thing to have if you have responsibilities that might be affected. Now, going back to the mortgage protection, a lot of people are under the impression that when they write their mortgage check every month, that the bill that they're paying for the mortgage coverage is actually protecting their family. It's not.
So hey, you guys, mean the PMI part, people who have PMI on their private mortgage insurance, that protects the bank. So
it protects the bank,
but
yes.
People have the illusion, unless they
because
met
it
me.
Says
they
mortgage.
Have no illusion if they met me, but other people... People who have not met me, they have the illusion that somehow that protects them, right?
And I talk to those people all the time. Oh, I'm paying for that. I'm paying for that. Well, that's to indemnify the bank against the loss. That is not protecting you or your family. Mm-hmm. So when you are thinking about mortgage protection, whether it is you want to protect the equity in the home, whether you want to cover the entire mortgage, or you want to make sure payments are made till the home can be sold, those are different things, and they are what I work with folks in putting into place.
Okay? Right. So you've got mortgage insurance in the insurance industry that you're in, and then there's the PMI right. insurance, private mortgage insurance. And sadly enough, or oddly enough, or maybe not odd, a lot of those companies are the same, like Genworth does both, right? So, it gets confusing, but because people see their mortgage coupon says Genworth and they're like, see? Like, no, that's PMI right. that protects. You got to put less down payment because you are willing to pay for that PMI, right? So that's different.
Correct.
Yeah. Okay.
And it should be said it's almost as big as the misconception that somehow when you're older, when you retire, you're going to be paying less tax. Those
right.
two things are the most common ones that I run into.
Huh.
And it's like, you wonder where people, and it's just, it's the telephone. you hear something and then you translate it and then it keeps translating until
finally, the telephone game. Yeah, yeah.
Everybody's confused. So just keep that in mind, guys. When you're looking at your mortgage and you see that part of your bill, it's not covering the family. It's not protecting against your loss.
Right.
It's protecting the bank. So, and it's an important part of the discussion to mention that, because for a lot of people, their home is their most significant investment. It's part of their retirement plan for a lot of people. So to know that is really a good thing to be considering. And ladies, for those of you who haven't had these conversations with your parents or with single siblings, it's a good idea to clarify that, because if you think for a second that you're going to be the one who's left behind picking up the pieces of that particular family member or loved one, then you should have that very well outlined, because the plan that you make is going to be affected by that discussion. Okay. Most of the time when I sit down with folks, they have a plan. They know their plan. Sometimes they don't, and that's fine. But I find myself oftentimes in a position where I have to be able to open up the doorway to that conversation. So
by what you just said, do you mean that if you're the family member that other family members are going to go to when their life falls apart,
mm-hmm.
then you kind of have the right to, or the obligation to, or the responsibility to bring that up now? Is that what you're saying? Because you said kind of so nice that I almost missed it, but that's what you're talking about, right? Is
that's exactly
when you're right. The go-to person to bail people out, I think is what you were talking about.
Well, there's that part of it. And then, you know, I'll talk to people who, some people literally have never had one conversation about what's going to happen after they pass away. And yeah. Others realize that there is some responsibility there that's going to be left on. I've maybe talked to three people who said to me, I don't care, I'll be dead. And I'm like, oh my God, that's horrible. But there's also the factor of, hey, mom, what's going to happen with the house? We need to figure that out. Because
yeah, we don't. It seems like very few people talk about it. And even less often, I think, women, right? Like we don't. I think we're more likely to, but it's just in society, for whatever reason, we don't talk nuts and bolts. Like how many right. of us go, hey, how much do you have in the bank, sister? You know,
right.
I know when my sister reaches zero, you know,
but you know, there's that factor. There's so many different elements of this, and the reason the conversation needs to be had is if you can protect your family and make sure that at the very least, the equity that you've built up in your home is able to be collected by the family instead of lost to the bank, let's put you in that position. Okay. Because all the years that you've spent building a legacy or developing this, like Athena, you gave a great example when we were speaking earlier about your, you were questioning what's going to happen to your husband if something happened to you
mm-hmm.
because you understood the impact of your business, the impact of your employees, the impact of just the household. And those things, they're real. And a lot of times you don't have time to have a conversation about them, but trust me, life happens and it gets in the way. And I have, I was fortunate enough to be able to help a woman in, her husband passed away very quickly, very, very quickly. He became ill and he passed away and he ended up, we had to transfer assets. Well, I was just glad that I was transferring them to his wife, because his 401k and his life insurances, he had no line of succession put in place. Had anything happened, it would have been a horrific mess, because they had five kids, his mom, and siblings, and had his wife not been still alive, it would have thrown the whole family in a tizzy. So those conversations, like what you just mentioned about if you're going to be the go-to person, they need to happen. Otherwise, things end up in probate, and then all you know, the assets end up mostly being awarded to the state.
Mm-hmm.
So be mindful of that. Be really, really mindful of that. Now here we are to the meat and potatoes of the conversation. And
yay, how do we grow our money? Let's do it.
Athena has been alluding to this the entire evening. So this is It's such a powerful tool. It literally is my favorite thing. Back in 1980, E.F. Hutton had a little brainchild that was called cash value life insurance. Okay. To be very clear, all whole life policies obtain cash value. They come with cash value. It's just part of the, it's baked in the cake. This particular type of coverage, though, it is actually designed to accumulate cash. So the death benefit is depressed, and the cash value, the cash accumulation side is heightened. Okay. So the reason that we put these in place is for the purpose of growing our money. Okay. Now, it's all in the premium payment. It's all baked in the cake. You see it all when you get your contract. So you can see the way that the insurance carrier is using the method that they're using to credit your account. You see all of that. You're in, because insurance carriers are not allowed to speculate with our money. This is not considered an investment. Okay. This is, it is life insurance. It is the way your money grows is it's being matched to indexes. So you will most likely have the opportunity to select the index that your money is matching. Okay. When we're working with this type of product, instead of doing this, like the market does, we are, instead of going up and down and that kind of like the Rocky Mountains look, it's like stair steps. So you're capturing gains as the market hits highs. Does that make sense? Okay. So when you're looking at this type of coverage, which is called Index Universal Life, indexed because it's matching indexes that you get to pick once a year. The way it works, so picture 2008 when the market lost 40% of its value. Okay, so if you had $1 million in your 401k, eventually you work your way all the way down to $600,000. All right. If you were getting to ready to retire in 2009, you lost the bottom and you lost it in a big way. It took 10 years for the market to come back from that loss. Okay. 10 years from the 2008. So from 2028 to 2018, the market, it took all that time for it to get back to 100%. Because when we lose, this is funny. I'm guessing that this group would probably answer this question correctly. A lot of people don't. But if the market loses 50% and you have $100,000 in your account at the end of the day, and you've lost 50%, you have to come, the market has to come back 100% for you to get back all that loss, if that makes sense, right?
So you lost 50% because it went from 100 to 50. But right. Then for 50 to become 100 is a doubling, not a 50%.
Exactly.
A 50% gross puts you at 75. You didn't make it back.
Exactly.
To right.
Exactly. So you end up in this kind of murky position. And then there's always the little jiggle jaggles, right? Mm-hmm. Well, in this case, it's more like steps. And when the market stays down for a long period, I like to think of it as you're on a landing. Now you've been climbing the steps. You're capturing the highs. And then all of a sudden you just hit a landing. So when the market take that same $100,000, you have $100,000 in your cash accumulation account, and the market has remained flat for an extended period of time, you're just on a landing. Okay. And you're just staying straight until the next high when you get to capture the highs. Okay. So
it might help to have some visuals to see how this works. See if you can share your screen. You should be able to because you're a host, or co-host or something, but let me know if it works.
Let me find my okay. It's telling me only hosts can share.
Okay, hang on. Make co-host. I wasn't sure if I had to do this or not. Yes. Okay. Now you should be able to do it. A little thing should come up that says that you now can share.
Okay. So, So just one more clarifying factor before we jump to the sharing. The elegance of the IUL comes in with Albert Einstein called it the eighth wonder of the world. It's compound interest. The rule of 72 says that every 7 years, your money is going to double in the most pure crediting circumstances. Okay. So that means that if you take 7 years, and you have $10,000, at the end of 7 years, you should have $20,000. And in another 7 year cycle, you have $40,000. In another 7 years, it's 80. So if that's just basic, it's very simple. Today, we don't see that a lot because we're dealing with fees and we're dealing with how much money costs and all of that. So because this is such a powerful tool, I'm going to show you what it looks like for an individual who, this is interesting. Okay. Can everybody
see? Yep. Your screen share started.
Okay. So right here, we're looking at a $250,000 face value. That's in the purple. See that?
That's the insurance portion, I guess, right?
That's what we call the face value. Yes.
Okay.
Now, if you need,
pardon.
Now here, the little part of the puzzle where if you live too long, because we do run out of resources, people do outlive their retirements.
Mm-hmm.
So
what color is the live too long part?
Live too long is green.
Okay.
And you see the accumulated cash values there in the little stair steps. So at age 69, the premiums that you've paid into your $250,000 policy would have netted you about $131,121. Okay. At 74, you're looking at $184,000. And then if you jump all the way to 84, you're looking at $364,000. That's compounding. Okay.
So that's how much my cash is worth at those different times.
Yes.
Oh, that's better. Whoa, that's big.
Okay. So the nice thing about this, the cash value portion, I think everybody understands that if you die, the family is going to be afforded a particular amount of money. That's the face there.
But tax-free, right?
Tax-free, yes.
Okay.
Now that there is a caveat to that, but I do work with my clients to avoid the issues that would relate to taxes. So that's definitely a discussion to have.
Okay. And can you scroll up? Because I think this, we skipped. So this illustration here is talking about investing 3,000 something per year, like 250 a month.
Yes. I'm sorry.
So that first bar is someone who's doing that amount of money in the plan.
Yes. Okay. Yes. This is your premium. And I base this, guys, on a 42-year-old female non-smoker in good health.
Okay.
And so this could potentially be this number here, the $3,082.50, if you're in stellar health, could be better. Okay, which means you'd have the $250,000 paying less money every month. Okay. Now, so if you need cash, now this, you can take a loan or a withdrawal. I always recommend that you take a loan because there is a way that you make sure that your money keeps growing while you've loaned against it. Those loans are never due and payable in your lifetime. And I'm going to show you a couple of other illustrations just to make sure that you understand how they work. So if you become ill, you see here, there's a lump sum for terminal illness. If you become chronically ill, let's say that you're somebody who needs care, a caregiver to come in, or you want to, you know, you're undergoing treatments, they'll send you a check for $3,700 a month. And then your critical illness lump sum and your critical injury lump sums are there. And I hope that makes sense.
Oh, that's fantastic. So the $250,000 policy is being given to you while you're still alive for these different situations.
And this is, it should be said that this is an option you're going to talk, you would call me, okay? Hey, Damaris, I'm sick. I don't know what I'm going to do. I'm not where I want to be. Hold on a second. I'm sorry, ladies. So you want to make sure that you're looking at, you want to make sure that you're looking at, okay. I wanted to show you the two in between, just so you can see how, are you still seeing that, Athena?
Well, we're seeing something called diverse crediting options to meet my needs. It skipped ahead like a few slides all of a sudden.
Okay.
But this is the power of money, right? So if you're putting in a $3,082 per year and you're 42 right now and you don't take it out till you're 69, you've only put in $77,000, but you have $139,000 or something. I forget what the number was on your thingy, but that's not bad since bells and whistles.
It's not. And when you realize why that is such a significant piece of information, it has to do with the, first of all, there's no taxes. So if you're, let's say that you're at a time of your life where you're in retirement and you want to tap this fund, you're not paying taxes on top of whatever you withdraw. Whereas if you pull money out of your 401k, you're going to be paying whatever state and federal taxes apply. Right. So you have to pull more to net the single digit that you want. So this is actually, it's incredibly powerful if for that reason alone. Okay. So,
and just as a reminder, if you borrow from your 401k, loans are always tax-free, right? It's when there's a taxable event, like a sale of an asset. So the problem is that if it's a 401k and you leave that employment, that loan has to be paid back because you're no longer an active employee contributing. So they want you to pay off the loan. So that's no good, right? So you can't borrow against your 401k, but then it's like being imprisoned in that job.
Right. And then you're stuck with whatever the terms are. And if you're under the age of 59 and a half, you have to snap on that extra 10% penalty.
And then the
other thing about the 401k, if you look here where it says cash value accumulation.
Mm-hmm.
So let's walk through this scenario and you're planning, you are as a super planner, you've got it all lined out and you've got it all put together and you've accumulated enough assets that you never have to tap this policy. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
So at age 65, so this is still, we're working on the $250,000. At age 65, you'd have the $98,000. At age 100, look at that number.
Wow. So that's leaving a huge chunk to your family.
Huge chunk to the family. And you don't have to worry about the tax that's going to be associated if you left that amount in your 401k. Mm-hmm. You don't have to worry about, I mean, there's so many things that are left unsaid in this scenario because they don't need to be said.
Yeah.
So you give yourself some real benefits and some real amazing experiences for your family when you do it right. So this is taking me, I'm going to pull up another document. Okay.
Oh, sure. And ladies, if you have questions, go ahead and put them in the chat box. And we'll fit them in where we can. And if not, we'll do it at the end. So just as a time check, it's 6:45 right now.
Oh, my goodness. Okay. So then let me just show you the small business option.
Okay.
So let's just say that you take this and you're a small business. And so what you're trying to do is make sure that key employees are either golden handcuffed tied to you or they are you seeing this?
Yeah, this slide says narrative summary says flex life index universal life in the corner up there.
Okay.
Is that the one you wanted?
No, hold on. So Zoom.
So one way that I've heard people using this is instead of like this is one of the ways I used it, instead of getting a car loan, I actually put the car payments into the insurance policy. So the insurance policy would grow. So I borrowed against my policy, right? And I mean, you're showing big numbers, but really in just a couple of years, you could probably have 20,000 saved in there, right? So so that's how I did it the first time is I borrowed money against the policy to buy the car and then made car payments to pay back that loan on the policy. So I didn't leave the loan sit there forever, right? Mm-hmm. But the interest rate was so much cheaper on this. And you didn't really talk about interest rates, but back then, well, this was, you know, late 90s, but back then I was paying 5 or 6%. But then when I did it again in 2009, I think it was, the interest rate was like 1%. So, mm-hmm. you know, it's always cheaper than the market, I guess, because they have assets to go against, right? Just like your 401k loan often is a cheaper interest rate than what you can get out in the market. But that's what I did is I borrowed the money for the car, the $20,000, and then I paid the $400 a month back into the policy instead of to the car dealership interest.
Now, the interesting thing about that is that, and that's one really popular way to use that. Mm-hmm. The interesting thing about that is you can, you'll take those funds. They are, the reason that they have to charge you an interest rate is because it's a loan. Mm-hmm. Because it's a loan that keeps it pure. So the IRS says, okay, fine. You don't, there's no tax associated.
Got
so
it.
This second illustration, just to show you from a small business perspective, for those of you who might be looking at it from this angle, mm-hmm. is $1 million policy. Now the company would own the coverage. Okay. They would own the policy, meaning the company would be the beneficiary. This is significant for those of you who have key employees that you don't want to lose. Let's say you have some really amazing young person who you don't want to lose. You want to keep their talent. This is kind of can be used as golden handcuffs. The benefit to the small business person is that it doesn't attach the same requirements as a 401k, where if you offer the 401k to one person in the business, you have to offer it to all. Okay. Yep. So in this, you can actually target the individual or individuals who you want. Maybe it's yourself. Maybe you want to make sure that when the time comes, whatever happens, you're covered. Maybe this is your way of providing a certain key employee with a retirement bonus, headhunting fees that you might come up with, making sure that if somebody becomes ill, that the business isn't having to be liquidated in order to take care of things. But you can see, so you see how the difference with $1 million in cash and face value. Okay. Mm-hmm. Obviously that premium is quite a bit higher. Again, this
it's like $1,000 a month, right?
Yep. Yep. And it's based on, a 42-year-old female non-smoker, but you see how the cash accumulation works in your favor if you'd like to write somebody a nice check for their retirement. But if you want to do it like the banks do with our money, you just drop the money in there, you let it grow, and then you have it to take off when you're ready to retire. So kind of nice,
yeah,
right?
It seems like, yeah. And so $1,000 times, so 12,000 times 25 years, right? I'm just rounding to make it easy. So you put in 300,000, but you have insurance benefits, your cash value is 541, which isn't bad. I mean, we'd rather it double. I mean, we'd rather, so I think the return is low. You're not seeing the doubling, but it's more secure than if it was market-based, right? If it was going through the gyrations of the market.
So let me see if I can pull that for you. So you'll
I think
here-
another question people have is like, out of the money that you put in, how much is paying for the premium and how much is investment? Like, what's the breakdown of where my dollars go?
You know, that's a really great question. And that is all, I'm going to be a little bit muddy here because it's not a one size fits answer. If you're younger, the benefit is greater. If you're older, that changes. If you're rated, that changes. So there's a little bit of complexity here.
So can I just clarify? So the younger you are, the fewer dollars that are going to the insurance, just because insurance is cheaper when you're young, right?
Well, It's interesting. That's another thing.
Or medical conditions or whatever that would cause the insurance to be more.
Yeah. So the way to think about it is it's the time of your life that you obtain the coverage that's always going to factor into what that price is going to be. But what happens is when we're building, like if I was to show you a whole life policy right now, the illustration would be markedly different in terms of the cash accumulation because more of the dollars are going to the premium. But remember what I said in the beginning, that in this case, we're depressing the face value and we're maximizing the cash accumulation. So the calculus that goes here, and that's why the indexing is so important, is you don't have to worry about what the whole market is doing. You're worried about your index, but the performance is based on how that index performed, and then you're credited accordingly. And that's all selected at the beginning. So when I run an illustration for you, there's actually a page in there that shows you the hypothetical credits. They can't say guaranteed because we don't know how the market's going to perform, but the hypothetical credits are there and you see the breakdown in the percentages, but that's different. That's one of those things that you really have to, you have to sit down and request an illustration. I'd be happy to run one. And then you could see what that would look like for your situation. Again, it's hypothetical because we haven't gone through underwriting. I'm not an underwriter per se. They call me a field underwriter in terms of the carriers, but I can't make that determination. So the rule of thumb, though, is, ladies, if you start with if you start one of these at 25, 35, 40, 42, you're starting at a good time to still take advantage of this. Now, one of the things that we would discuss is how you're paying into your policy and strategies to make sure that you're maximizing the opportunity to put as much money in the growth position as possible. So your premiums, there is a portion of your money that's going towards the face value, whatever the face might be. And then you continue on with that to the cash value. And every policy, every whole life policy that I sell actually has a cash value accumulation. The one rule of thumb, and this is something that I'd like for each of you to consider if you're thinking about doing an IUL. The face value that you see there, okay, you see that $1 million figure? One of the general rules is that Congress put in place is you can keep that policy from becoming taxable as long as your cash value never exceeds the face value.
Ah, interesting.
So if you're using this as retirement, if you're using this as a fund that's going to help you to, especially if you're relying upon it in retirement, you want to get as high a face as you can possibly manage in your budget because you're going to want to have as much access to that cash. Now, at some point in this illustration, the cash value, the face of the amount of the policy will exceed will be exceeded by the cash. And at that point, you start seeing the face value grow. So the illustrations went, it's not in every scenario, but you will see that in later years. So this is, there's some general rules of thumb that will make this a non-taxable event. And basically, we've gone over everything in terms of the good parts of it. And the only thing that's left to be said from my perspective, and Athena, I don't know who you had your IULs with, but these are flexible premiums.
Right. You can change how much you contribute, right?
Yes. And that can be based on, so let's say that you're self-employed and your income is volatile, right? You're slower in the spring, you're super gangbusters in summer and fall. But if you're looking at this and you're seeing, okay, I've got $3,000 a year that I have to come up with, there is a minimum premium that will keep coverage in place. And the reason I recommend these for self-employed individuals is because oftentimes our income, it's like a little bit of a water snake, it's going, it's going, it's going. And with this type of coverage, what you're able to do is take a look, whether it's quarterly or biannually or annually, you get to the end of the calendar year of your policy or your coverage, and you're okay, I have an additional X amount I'm going to push towards that. Mm-hmm. So you can actually make this something that's very affordable, that makes it very doable for the individual. And that target premium is a range, but it protects you. It protects you from turning this into a taxable, we call it a MEC or a modified endowment contract. That means it's now taxable. So there's strategies to help you avoid that scenario and make sure that you're maximizing your money and its ability to grow.
Okay, so I have a question. We have a few questions. So how much can you borrow percentage-wise? Can you borrow 50%? Because it's kind of like a margin account with stocks, right? They limit how much you can, you know, leverage your account. So in just in general, or maybe you have a range, how much can you borrow? Once you've got the cash in there, how much can you borrow against it?
That's another funky question, because it depends on the amount of the cash. Most carriers have a rule of thumb. They say you can go up to 70%. You can go up to 90%. You have to keep something in play in there to make sure that you're holding on to your value, uh-huh. and you're not turning it into there's all kinds of other situations. One of them, a scenario that came up today was I had to take a test. Taking out too much money too soon throws red flags.
Sure. So, money laundering flags. Right.
Yep. So being mindful of that there are rules that you're going to be asked to comply with, but it's all there in the contract.
Okay.
It's there in the illustrations. I can, anybody who specifically wants more information on that, please shoot me your email or your phone number. I can text you and I'll provide you with the language that applies to, but mm-hmm. just know that each carrier is a little bit different.
Okay.
Okay. So they'll let you take out X amount, and that amount increases obviously as time goes.
Okay. Okay. And then, so Susie had a question, about strategy a little bit. Is it better if you're married to apply together, or is it better to have your separate, policies? Are there pros and cons, or strategies for married couples on how to approach this? I would think I would want to be separate, so we each get to put our own money in our own accounts and grow it even faster than together, I think. But how does that work when you're married? You're different ages, different health, maybe.
So that last one's huge, the health, because you can have a spouse who's ill and one who's in great health, right? If you combine policies, you're basically basing the premiums on the ill partner. Okay. So in a lot of cases, I would not recommend that. The other reason I wouldn't recommend this, and it's a safeguard, this is another reason I think doing this while you're young is huge. Mm. You have the policy in place, you get married, you go through a divorce, God forbid.
And you skipped the honeymoon and the happy times.
I did.
There was some good stuff, and then the divorce came. Okay.
But if you have the policy established, it's going nowhere. It's not an asset. So
in a divorce, they can't take your insurance policy away from you?
In a divorce.
And is that because it's not a cash asset? Like it's not an asset. A mutual fund account? Yeah.
It's a liability. So this is not something that can be attained in a lawsuit. If you have, I don't care if you've got $15 million in your IUL, it's going nowhere if you're sued for every penny you own. So you have there are some safeguards in this that really make it a powerful deal. So in my opinion, I would never, at least unless there were specific circumstances happening, I would never recommend that you go with both on one, because you're putting too much of one egg in the basket, so to speak. Mm. And if you leverage both, then you also get to manage behind the payout, because if you have a life insurance policy that's attached to a spouse, the survivorship means that the spouse who survives is not going to see the payout until after they pass. Okay, the cash value is there, there are other assets there, but you're not necessarily going to see a payout like you would in the event of the
covered separately.
So there's some benefit. There are some benefits to doing it separately that makes sense. And also because, you know, God forbid something heinous happens, you don't want to stop being able to accumulate because of an illness or an injury that happened to a spouse.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Next question. Should you get a policy on children? Since age matters, is it possible to get a policy on someone else besides yourself who might be younger and still use it? Or is it only the person who's the insured person who gets to use it? How does that work?
So number one, the owner of the policy determines what happens to the policy. So it doesn't matter if you're if I present to a carrier that you, Athena, are you're taking out an IUL, but your husband is going to be the owner, they're going to come back to me and ask why. I'll have to give them a legitimate factual reason why. So if you're going to take a policy on someone who's younger, just have that clearly defined. Who is going to be the owner? And it comes up very quickly in the application process. It's not something that you get away from.
Mm.
Number two, if you're going to take this out, I highly recommend this for children as young as possible, because the other great thing about the IUL is you can use it to pay for college. But if the child doesn't intend to go to college by the time they hit 18.
Yeah, they could change their mind, right?
They can change
their
mind.
They want to be a rock star.
They want to be a rock star and they want to fund that. And you don't have to. Exactly. So the other factors that I typically recommend that you look at when you're looking at a child. So the premiums are lower. There's a huge advantage there because we're doing something that we call guaranteeing insurability. You never know when a diabetes diagnosis is going to come, leukemia, whatever it is, you never know. And so if you insure the child as young as possible, then you're doing them a favor. You're doing yourself a grand favor. Now, mindful word to the wise, I typically recommend that you plan to keep the premiums at some kind of manageable state so that at one point you could pass them on, that bill on to the child.
Mm.
Okay. And whatever they decide to do, however they decide to do it, you know, you've got their college fund there. They didn't go to college. You've got their, you know, maybe it's about cash flow or just being able to access their money. You don't have to worry about buying that first car. It's all set and covered. I actually have a friend whose father, as she and her siblings were born, he took out IUL policies on all of them. And that's how he wrote their checks for college. So it was, you know, it was a beautiful thing that he put in place years and years ago, and it worked out wonderfully.
That totally makes sense. And this kind of is an alternative, let's say, to the 529s and the Coverdales and everything, because those are specific to education, whereas this gives you some flexibility.
And there's no tax hit if the child decides not to go to college.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, with the 529, you have to pass it down to the next. So if it's grandparents, if I'm buying this for my granddaughter, I have to hope, and she decides she's not going to college because she's going to be a rock star, which she is. She plays the guitar beautifully. If you take her, if I say, okay, Avery, I'm going to set you up with this thing and you're going to college. And then she says, no, Murmur, I'm not going to college. Then with the 529, I have to pass it to her sibling
mm-hmm.
or another blood relative.
Or go back to school yourself. You could go back to school yourself, use it yourself.
Or go back to school myself.
Yeah.
Okay. There's always that, right? But you have to do that. Otherwise, you recognize a tax hit.
Right.
So the idea that we want to make sure that you're looking at options, you're actually being global about it, this is the way. So people will set these up. Oh, talking about age, leveraging age. So going back to that. So people who are very, very future thinking, they will take a sizable IUL out on the oldest insurable member of their family. And when that individual passes, they roll that into the next eldest insurable member of the family. And what they end up doing by way of this is they create a family bank. So you can use this as a tool that's going to help to provide for legacy down the road. And it's very simple. It's all in the basics that I've shared with you tonight. It's all there. And it's just, it's easy to understand. And it just makes sense.
And why are we doing the oldest person?
Because that person is likely going to pass first. Mm. And when they pass away, that, so in a way, this is almost doing it like the corporation would use it. You take out, because the other reason is all life insurance, when we're dealing with coverage, it depends on they will only let you take a max of 30 times annually your income. So if you're doing that on a child, there are limitations. Either mom and dad, or mom or dad, or grandma and grandpa, however the carrier mixes it, has to be insured for at least sometimes double. So if you're doing it on the eldest person, then that requirement falls away. Mm. Because clearly, you know, the insurance company is like, why are you insuring your three-year-old for $3 million? Mm. There's no reason for that indemnification. It's not something you have to recognize ever, right? Unless your child is a working actor or model or whatever, where they're actually earning money in those sums. So when you're looking at the eldest person, generally their age and their income is the wise choice.
Okay. Because then you get the payout of the insurance and you roll that into the next.
Yep.
And the insurance company doesn't see that as problematic.
Not at all. Because you're not abusing the system. Mm-hmm. You are leveraging the system. The very first time I explained the IUL to somebody, it was a husband of a friend of mine. He said, "Does the IRS know about this?"
Right. Some of this stuff you go, you know.
Yes, they do. And the whole thing is this, however the family handles that particular circumstance is fine as long as you're within the guidelines that are set. And they are very strict, but they make sense.
Mm-hmm. Well, that's fantastic. So we've come to the end of our time. We actually went over a little bit over. So thank you very much, Damaris, for helping us understand this just a little bit better. And I think it's a great way to create that pension for sure, if you've given yourself enough time, I think. But you could run numbers on anybody to see, you know, how this would work, right? Do I deposit $1,000 a month? How much do I need to give and how much do I get out, right? And right. How soon? That's what I would want to know, right? The rest is all details, I guess.
Yes.
So if someone wanted to get a hold of you, what's the best way to get a hold of you? Emails, phone, how would that
be? You can call or text me. My phone number is 562-233-1481. And if you prefer,
can you repeat that one more time?
Sure. It's 562-233-1481. And if you'd like to email me, you can email me at djohnson. So that's djohnsonffl20@gmail.com.
And I'm just having you talk it through for the podcast people that are out there. Obviously, the people, we could just type it in here, but for people in podcast land, they need to hear it. So.
Yeah, no problem. Do you want me to repeat that one more time?
One more time to reach Damaris. How do we do that?
djohnsonffl20@gmail.com.
Okay, well, thank you so much, Damaris, for coming. Thank you, everyone who attended tonight. I really appreciate it. Hopefully you learned something. And our next, we have several Women in Investing events coming up. So be sure to go to womeninvesting.com to see the upcoming events. And if you're on our meetup group, that would be meetup.com/women-in-investing. And you can see our events coming up there. And we have some awesome speakers coming up. I have 5 different authors who are going to join us, different authors that have, so Lorelei Stevens, who, created a fortune out of note investing. And then Tiffany Elish, who is the budgetista, and she's had a hardship, so she's been moved to April or May. But she is a fabulous lady who is going to teach us how to better manage our money and our budget. And then Maya Peterson, who wrote a book about women in investing at the age of 17. Her actual first published book was at 14. And then I just want to show you this. So you can see, well, I don't know if you can see, she does look quite young. And this is her book she wrote at the age of 17 called Lighthouse. She interviewed a bunch of women who are in the finance industry. And she calls women who support each other and are mentors and examples of what we want to be lighthouses. And I just loved that. So hopefully she'll be joining us in the next couple of months and we can all cheer her on. And you know, there's wisdom in children. So, you know, good for her. And I can't wait to hear from her. So I hope you'll join us for our upcoming events. Thanks for joining us tonight. And we will see each other very soon, hopefully live in person here in the Los Angeles area. So thank you for joining us. And we'll see you soon. Good night, everybody.
Good night.
Good night.